Okay, so welcome back. Last time we discussed, we defined the decomposition group and the inertia group and the decomposition field, and we proved the characterization of the decomposition field. And what else did we do? And then we put some effort in proving that the residue fields corresponding to the base field and the decomposition field, they are actually equal. So this also we proved last time. So we will continue from there. Let me start sharing the screen. So today is lecture 8, maybe. Please confirm that you can see the slides.
Yes.
So let's start then. So these first two words, decomposition and inertia, we saw last time. How is it defined? So we know that the primes lying above a prime, they are Galois conjugates. You're assuming that L over K is a Galois extension. And the primes lying above are Galois conjugates, and those sigma which fix a prime, that is a decomposition group. So that's a subgroup of the Galois group. And then we stated without proving, which we will prove today, that from the decomposition group to the Galois group of the residue fields. So the corresponding residue field extensions, we will prove it's Galois. And then you have the Galois group, and you have a natural map, and this map is surjective. So this also we stated, we will prove it today, it is surjective. And there's a natural morphism, its kernel is called the inertia map, inertia group. And then we will introduce the Frobenius automorphism and the Artin automorphism, and that will be the last slide of today. Okay, so we need to prove surjectivity of this map, we need to prove that the extension is Galois, and the surjectivity of the map, and introduce these things. So that's what we will do today. So recall that last time, so we are going to assume that P is maximal, and I gave two reasons why we are assuming that. One, by localizing, all the proofs will go through for prime ideals also. By localizing, you can convert yourself to the maximal situation. And another reason that I said is we don't quite care because soon we will be dealing with number fields, ring of integers, and ring of integers in number fields will be our rings. And they are all of dimension one, full dimension one. Every non-zero prime ideal is maximal. So we will be dealing only with maximal ideals. So I gave these two reasons. And so I have stated it here. It's not necessary for the final results, but that will be the case of interest to us. Last time we defined decomposition and decomposition group and the inertia group, which I just recalled, and they correspond to a maximal ideal capital P, which is lying above small p. And then we characterize the decomposition field as the smallest extension with some property. Could one of you recall it? So decomposition field is the fixed field of the decomposition group. So it will lie between, so if you have a integrally closed quotient field K and a Galois extension L of K, and B is the integral closure of A in L. This is the picture that you have. And decomposition field is a field in between L and K. And what was this characterization? It is smallest with what property? Can one of you recall? Right, so this has the, so if you take capital P above and intersect with this field, then that is the only prime lying above, right? Because the Galois group of the Galois group corresponding to the decomposition field by definition is the decomposition group. And that has the property that it fixes all the primes. So there is only one prime lying above. And then we proved that this is the smallest extension of k contained in L with this property that p is the only prime lying above it. So in between k and L, this is the smallest extension with a certain property, and this property is that capital P is the only prime lying above P intersection. So this is the smallest extension, let us say E, such that capital P is the only prime lying above P intersection E. This is what we showed, and we also showed that A and BD have the same residue fields. What was the main idea of this proof? This is where we stopped last time. You had to show that A by P is contained in BD by the corresponding prime, let us say capital Q. So A by P to BD by Q, you have a map, natural map, and you wanted to show that it's a surjection. So starting with X in BD, you had to produce an element, a pre-image in A. And how did we get something in A? We got something in A because we cooked up a Y corresponding to X, and we took norm of Y, norm from KD to K. And so in order to do this, we used Chinese remainder theorem. So we used Chinese remainder theorem twice. One was in the proof of this, and the one was at the very starting. You know, all the primes lying above a given prime, they're Galois conjugates. That also was basically Chinese remainder theorem. So Chinese remainder theorem we used in order to show that primes lying above a given prime, they are all Galois conjugates of each other. That is the first time we used, and second time we used in order to show that the residue fields of the base field and the decomposition field, the residue fields are actually the same, they are equal. So once in this proof and once at the very start, these are Galois conjugates, are all the primes lying above are Galois conjugates. Today we will show first that this natural map is surjective. So first we will show that this is actually a Galois extension. Assume separability and then this is Galois. So what we will show is that this is a normal extension. So this is the residue field of B. Sometimes I might say residue field of L, but what I really mean is residue field of B, and this is the residue field downstairs A by P, and this field extension we will show that this is normal under our conditions. A is integrally closed, L over K Galois. Under these conditions we will show that this is a normal extension. Assume separability also. So I have the Galois group and I have the natural map here, and we will show that this is surjective. Remember that inertia group is a kernel of this morphism. What is this morphism? If you take a sigma here, it goes to sigma bar, where sigma bar of B bar is sigma of B whole bar. And that is well defined because you are taking something from the decomposition group. Then we will introduce the so-called Frobenius and Artin morphisms, and we will stop there. Okay, so that's the menu for today. So first let's prove that B by beta, not beta, as I said, I might say beta because it looks like beta. It is capital P. The tech is math frac capital P. So first we will show that B by P, capital P, is normal over A by small p. So we have all these things as usual. A is integrally closed. K is the quotient field of A. L is a Galois extension, a finite Galois extension of K. B is the integral closure of A in L. P is a prime ideal below. We are assuming it is maximal actually, and therefore capital P is also maximal. So these are as usual. A is integrally closed, L over K is Galois, P and capital P are maximal. First claim is the normality. So we want to show that. So let's denote this by B bar, the residue field, B by capital P. That's a field because capital P is maximal. So this is a field, and this is a normal extension of A bar, which is A by P. So what do you need to show? What is the meaning of normal? So we need to show that for every alpha in B bar, all the roots of its minimal polynomial over A bar, all its roots also belong to B bar, right? This is one of the characterizations of normality. So if you take any element in B bar in the larger field and you consider its minimal polynomial, all its conjugates, all the other roots of the minimal polynomial also belong to B bar. Minimal polynomial is over A bar, so it's a normal extension of A bar. Okay, so this is what we will do first. So start with alpha in B bar. Take arbitrarily one alpha in B bar. Consider its minimal polynomial. Show that its other roots are also in B bar. Okay, so take alpha in B bar. So correspondingly, there will be an alpha in B. There will be something in B, because B bar by definition is the image of B under the reduction mod P map. So alpha will be of the form X bar for some X in B by the definition of B bar. Okay, now for this X, you consider its minimal polynomial. So X will have its minimal polynomial, let us say f of x. Its coefficients will be in k, but x is also integral. So this f is actually in ax. Coefficients are in a because of integrality. Okay, and moreover, we know that if you have an element which is integral, and if you take its minimal polynomial, then all the other roots are also integral, all the coefficients are also integral, etc. Right? All the other roots are integral because they are all image under a homomorphism, so they are also integral. So all the roots of F are integral over A, and that means F factorizes linearly in B. So F can be written as product of X minus Xi, where one of the Xi's is the given X and the other Xi's are the other roots. They are all integral. So this factorization is not just in kx, not just in lx, but it's actually in b. So xi's are in b. The factorization is in bx. Okay, xi's are in b. So now you take the reduction mod map. So if you take the reduction mod map, you will get f bar equal to product of x minus xi bar, right? So reduction mod map is what? Reduction mod map is on all the coefficients. Coefficients are in B, all the coefficients, you apply the reduction mod map. But that is same as applying on the roots. So F bar, you get this as a product. What do we need to show? We need to show that if you take the minimal polynomial of X bar, minimal polynomial of alpha, all the other roots, you want to show that they also belong to B bar. That's what we need to show. So you get F bar equal to this. So F bar factors linearly in B bar. So f of x is 0, right? X is one of these roots. F is the minimal polynomial of x. And therefore, the corresponding x bar, if you take f bar of x bar is 0. So x bar is a root of this. So what can you say about the minimal polynomial of x bar?
Minimal divide f bar.
Say that again. Yeah, minimal polynomial of x bar will divide f bar. And all the roots of f bar are in b bar. So in particular, all the roots of the minimal polynomial of x bar are also there in b bar. That's all. So in particular, all the roots of the minimal polynomial of x bar over a bar belong to b bar. Indeed, as you just said, was that Manav? Is that Manav who just made this remark?
Yes.
Yeah. So as Manav just said, the minimal polynomial of x bar divides f bar. So all the other roots are also there. So that is easy. That shows that the extension is normal. Moreover, from our argument, we have got a little bit more. What we have achieved is, if you take any X bar and if you attach it to A bar, you get this field A bar of X bar, right? A bar bracket X bar. And its degree over, sorry, there should be a bar here. Its degree over A bar, what can you say? So what will be this degree? This degree is the degree of the minimal polynomial of x bar. But degree of the minimal polynomial of x bar is what? It is less than or equal to degree of f bar, because minimal polynomial is a factor of that f bar. So it is less than or equal to degree of f bar, but degree of f bar is equal to degree of f. And degree of f is what? Degree of f is the degree of k bracket x over k. So this is, so I should put a bar here. This is less than or equal to kx, the degree of kx over k, but kx is contained in L. So that is bounded by the degree of L over k. So this also we see.
Shouldn't particular, it be a bar of x bar colon a bar?
That's what I said. There's a typo. I should put a bar. Yeah. So just remind me at the end also, I should put a bar here. It's a typo. Yeah. It's a bar of x bar over a bar. That is the degree of the minimal polynomial of x bar, which divides the degree of f bar. And the degree of f bar is same as degree of f, which is this. But kx is contained in L, so that's less than or equal to L over k. In particular, observe that the maximal separable sub-extension of a bar in b bar. So suppose you don't assume separability, which I will assume, because after all, you know, number fields, when we take, the residue fields are finite. And you know that the finite fields, any extension is separable. That will be the case of interest to us. But right now, I have not assumed that. So if you take the maximal separable sub-extension of a bar in b bar, its degree is also finite. Why does it follow? You take a bar and you take the maximal separable sub-extension. So that is something which is contained in b bar. Equal to b bar if b bar over a bar is separable. Otherwise, it may be strictly contained in b bar, but that degree is finite. Why is that? You have to use a result from field theory.
Because b bar is finite, no? So.
No, b bar over a bar, we don't know, right?
Oh.
What we proved is a bar, x bar, this degree is finite. But b bar, right now, we are not assuming as anything we don't know. But this follows. If you take the maximal separable sub-extension of a bar in b bar, that degree is finite, follows from this, and the answer is there in the slide somewhere. Just look at the slide, throughout the slide. Answer is there in the slide.
Primitive element.
Yeah, that's a title, right? So primitive element theorem. It's a finite degree and this degree is bounded by L over K. So what does primitive element theorem say? A separable extension is generated by a primitive one element, which is called the primitive element. So there will be an X bar which generates the separable extension of a bar will be generated by some one element, and then this goes through, so it is finite. Okay, so that is a primitive element theorem. Okay, so now we will show surjectivity of that map. So what is the map? Let's also assume it's separable. Yeah, so here also there's an extra pause which I will delete. So two typos as of now. So now we consider the map sigma going to sigma bar. From where to where? Sigma is in GP. And this is Galois group of B bar over A bar. Let me assume it's separable. Okay. Where sigma bar of X bar is defined as sigma of X whole bar. And this is well defined. So the claim is that this map is surjective. Okay. This is what we need to show. So we have seen last time you remember this? This is where we stop last time. This is where we use Chinese remainder theorem the second time in order to show that A by P is same as BD by the prime lying above P. So in our today's notation, A bar is same as BD bar. BD is the integral closure of A in the decomposition field LD, and further bar means residue field. And we have proved that these two are equal. Okay. So this is going to be crucially used. So we have seen that these two are equal, and therefore we may assume that our base field is the decomposition field without loss of generality. Why is that? This is a crucial step. Do you follow this step? I'm saying that without loss of generality, let me assume that my base field is a decomposition field. In other words, I'm assuming without loss of generality that G equal to GP. Why is this okay? This is okay because what are we going to show? We want to show that this map is surjective. But Galois group of B bar over A bar, and we just saw that A bar is same as BD bar. The integral closure of A in the decomposition field, its residue field is same as A bar. So a bar is equal to that bd bar. So you can replace this by bd bar. So if you take an element here, you need to get a pre-image. But these two sets are same. Galois group of b bar over a bar is same as Galois group of b bar over bd bar, because a bar is equal to bd bar. So you can take, if you take something in this, that is same as that set. And if you take something in that, so if you take something in that, and if you have shown that this is a pre-image, then you have shown this in particular. Okay, so without loss of generality, you can assume this because those two sets are equal. But one great advantage of this assumption is, under this assumption, you have GP equal to what? If you assume that K is LD, then GP is the full Galois group. Okay. That was the definition of the decomposition field. And let us call this G. And this is going to be useful. Let's assume this is separable. So B bar equal to A bar of X bar, primitive element, for some X bar, where X is in B. And let F be the minimal polynomial of X over K. And so if you take something in the Galois group of B bar over A bar, you are looking at all automorphisms of B bar which will fix A bar. But any automorphism of B bar will be determined by its effect on X bar, because it's generated by X bar, right? So an automorphism of B bar is determined by its effect on X bar. What will be its effect? It will map X bar to some root of F bar. In fact, an automorphism of B bar, what will be its real effect on X bar? You take the minimal polynomial of X bar, which will be a factor of F bar. You take the minimal polynomial of X bar, and X bar will be mapped to some other root of the minimal polynomial of X bar, which will in particular be some root of F bar. So, okay, so in particular, X bar will be mapped to some root of F bar, let us say Y bar, where, what do you know about Y? Some other root of F bar from this earlier thing that we have seen here. F factorizes over B, and F bar is this. So some other root of F bar will be a Y bar, where Y is in B. Y is in B because of integrality, etc. Okay, so the argument that we have seen earlier, you know that this will be, where are we? You know that this will be, some other root of F bar will be of the form Y bar, which corresponds to a root Y of F. This Y is in B. That's why bar makes sense. Bar you can apply only if it's in the ring. So Y is in B and Y bar makes sense, and that will be another root. So if you take an arbitrary automorphism of B bar over A bar, I want to exhibit a pre-image in G beta, in GP. That's what I need to show for surjectivity. So an arbitrary automorphism of B bar over A bar will map X bar to Y bar. Okay. Now I have to produce something in GP such sigma, such that sigma bar of X bar is Y bar. That's what I have to do. So there exists a sigma. Right. Now, where are you? You have X is in B, F is the minimal polynomial, Y is another root of the minimal polynomial. Therefore, there is a sigma in the Galois group which will take X to Y, right? In Galois theory, the roots of the minimal polynomials are Galois conjugates. So X is a root of F, Y is a root of F, F is irreducible. Therefore, there is a Galois element which will take X to Y. So there is a sigma such that sigma of X equal to Y. Sigma is in the Galois group of L over K. So then sigma bar of X bar is Y bar, right? Because what is your definition of sigma bar of X bar? This by definition is sigma of X whole bar, but sigma of X is Y. So this is okay. Sigma bar of X bar is Y bar. And you have lifted this sigma bar to sigma, right? So sigma, if you take an automorphism, it will map X bar to Y bar. And that automorphism, you have got a pre-image. It is this sigma. This sigma, if you reduce, that has the property that it takes X bar to Y bar. So sigma bar is a given automorphism. So you have got something in the pre-image, but this is the full Galois group. This is the full Galois group. Whereas what do you have to show? The assertion was that from GP, the decomposition group to this Galois group of residue field extension, the map is surjective. What you have got is a sigma in the full Galois group, but that's okay. That's okay because GP is same as the full Galois group by our assumption. Because we assume that K is the decomposition field without loss of generality. So producing a sigma in the Galois group is enough because Galois group is same as the decomposition group. Okay, so that reduction was very, very crucial for this step. And the reduction is okay because of our last class. We proved that A by P is same as BD by the corresponding prime ideal. Because of that, the reduction is justified. And because the reduction is justified, Galois theory solved the problem. Okay. One remark is that without the Galois assumption, meaning I don't need to assume that B by P is separable over A by P, even then I can do this. You know, I mean, you can argue with the maximal separable sub-extension, which will be generated by something. And then the Galois group, that's the definition. Galois group, the notation Galois group would mean the Galois group of the maximal separable sub-extension. So it's the same proof. Okay. Don't bother about this because for us, residue fields are going to be finite and any extension is going to be separable. Okay, so this is an important proof, the surjectivity, and I hope this is clear. Is there any question? Okay, if not, let's continue. So the crucial step is Galois theory solve the problem because you are assuming K is the decomposition field, and you can assume K is the decomposition field because A by P is same as BD by capital Q. Okay, so here also is an extra post, so three typos. So there are three corollaries in Lang to this result that we have just proved, the surjectivity. Let us state and prove all three of them. So first of all, let phi be the natural map from A to A mod P. The reduction. Yeah, is there a question?
In the last time, you assumed that B mod A is separable,
right?
B over A. B bar
over A bar. I assumed till here that B bar over A bar is separable, yes.
The remark is
Lang does not assume so. This remark is that in Lang, he doesn't assume that. But what he means by the Galois group is if your extension is not separable, but normal, by Galois group, one means Galois group of the maximal separable extension. So it's the same proof, it's the same thing. And my last remark, which I just said verbally, is don't bother because separability is always there for us. Okay. So let phi denote the reduction mod P map. It's a canonical homomorphism, X going to X plus P. Okay. And let psi 1 and psi 2 be two extensions of a phi. So this is from B to, so this bar is the algebraic closure. So A by P is a field because P is maximal. And fix one algebraic closure, A by P bar. And let psi 1 and psi 2 be morphisms from B extending this morphism. Be two homomorphisms such that psi I restricted to A is this phi. Okay, so what this means is kernel of psi 1 and kernel of psi 2 are primes lying above P. That's what this means. So the claim is that there exists an automorphism of L over K. L is the quotient field of B and K is the quotient field of A. There is such an automorphism such that one is obtained from the other by composing with this. So if there are two homomorphisms which extend the canonical morphism, the claim is that there is a sigma from Galois group of L over K such that one of them, psi 1, is the other, psi 2, composed with sigma. Makes sense, no? Because what is the effect of, so what is psi 2 composed sigma? It is a map from where to where? Sigma is a map of from L to L. So you are applying it on B. So sigma of B is B, right? Because sigma of integral is integral. So B is the integral closure. So by definition, it's integrally closed. So sigma of B is B. So sigma will take B to B, and then you are applying psi 2. So that will be here. That will be here. On the other hand, psi 1 is here. So both psi 1 and psi 2 compose sigma are from B valued in here, and they are equal. Such a sigma exists. This is the claim. Okay. So the proof, consider the kernels of these two maps, these two homomorphisms. They will be prime ideals, and in fact they will be maximal ideals. They will be lying over P. Okay, so these two are prime ideals in B, and we know that under the Galois condition, all the prime ideals lying above a prime ideal, they are Galois conjugates. So there exists a tau such that, let's call this capital P, kernel psi 1. This is tau of kernel psi 2, because kernel psi 1 and kernel psi 2 are prime ideals lying above a given P. That you should check using the fact that psi 1 and psi 2 extends phi. From that it will follow. Therefore, one will be the Galois conjugate of the other. But you can check what is tau of kernel psi 2. So it's a small check that it is nothing but kernel of psi 2 composed tau inverse. Okay, let me call psi 2 composed tau inverse to be psi 3. I forgot to put a pause here. So this is kernel of psi 3. Psi 3 is by definition this one. Okay, so what have you got? You have got the kernel psi 1 is equal to kernel psi 3. In other words, psi 1 of B, the image of psi 1, image of psi 1 is what? Image of psi 1 is B by, image of psi 1 is isomorphic to B by kernel of psi 1. So because kernel of psi 1 is equal to kernel of psi 3, B by the kernel of psi 1, which we are calling capital P, is isomorphic to psi 1 B. It is also isomorphic to psi 3 B, because the kernels are actually equal. Okay, so you have got an isomorphism between psi 1 B and psi 3 B. Psi 1 B and psi 3 B are contained in the algebraic closure of A by P. And you have got this isomorphism. Let's call that isomorphism omega. There's a full stop missing here. So let's call that isomorphism omega. So it's an isomorphism from psi 1 of B to psi 3 of B. That means omega composed psi 1 is psi 3, right? Omega is a map from psi 1 of B to psi 3 of B. Psi 1 of B is an extension of A by P. And on that extension, you are getting this morphism omega. So omega composed psi 1 is psi 3. So omega is something from Galois group of B by P over A by P. Omega is a morphism of, automorphism of B by P. So by the earlier result, you know that that map is surjective. So corresponding to omega, you will get a sigma, such that the reduction will be omega. Okay. But you can also write down something which reduces to omega, which is omega composed psi 1, and you put a psi 1 inverse here. So this is not quite correct, because psi 1 inverse may not make sense. But just to argue, just to give the intuition behind what I'm saying, if you multiply this by psi 1 inverse, where is this now? So psi 1 is on B, omega. So psi 1 is on B valued in A by P bar. Omega is there itself, A by P bar again. And psi 1 inverse will be in B. So this is a map from B to B, if this makes sense. But psi 1 inverse will make sense modulo P. So modulo P, this makes sense. And this is what is giving. So this is a map from B to B, which gives you omega. So this reduces mod P to omega. But something that, this reduces mod P to omega. And you know that omega has an inverse image because of surjectivity. So omega has an inverse image in GP, the decomposition group. So the conclusion is, this is a lift of omega, and therefore the conclusion is that there is something in GP, let's say eta, such that this is equal to eta. This is equal to eta. See, I use this just to get the argument, I mean, just to get an easy argument in order to write this down. This is what perfectly makes sense. psi 1 inverse quite doesn't make sense. But omega compose psi 1 equal to psi 1 compose eta is a perfect statement. This makes sense. So there is an eta such that, so the basic argument is, this is a lift of omega, and a lift of omega coincides with something in GP. Because GP to the Galois group of the residue field extension, that is surjective. So therefore, this is equal to eta. In other words, omega composed psi 1 is psi 1 composed eta. So there is such an eta. And then we are done, because psi 3 is omega composed psi 1. So psi 3 is psi 1 composed eta. But if psi 3 is psi 1 composed eta, then psi 2 is, this is psi 3. So psi 2 is psi 1 composed eta tau. Psi 2 is psi 1 composed eta tau. That's what we wanted to show. Eta and tau are from the Galois group. So eta tau is in the Galois group. We wanted to show that there is a Galois element such that psi 1 is psi 2 composed something. And that's what we have proved, that psi 2 is psi 1 composed something. And that's a Galois element. Tau is something from the Galois group, and this eta is in the decomposition group. In fact, the product is in the Galois group. And we want to say that there is something in the Galois group such that one is obtained by composing with the other. Okay. All right. Next corollary is, suppose capital P is the only prime lying above P. So let's recall, you know, in one of the lectures, not the last lecture, but the lecture before that, we had this slide called explicit description. What was the content of that? And this I, you know, quickly recalled again in the last class at the very starting, because Manav asked me to explain it once again. What was the basic idea? If you are in a situation where B is generated as a ring by one element over A, then primes lying above a prime, there is a way to understand using the minimal polynomial of that element. You take the minimal polynomial of that element and you reduce mod P, factorize it, and the primes lying above will correspond to these factors. That's what we saw last time. And that idea you keep in mind. And this is similar to that. So if you believe in that philosophy, if capital P is the only prime lying above P, what can you say about the corresponding minimal polynomial? See, primes lying above correspond to factors of the minimal polynomial. Minimal polynomial, you reduce mod P f bar and the factors of f bar. So if there is only one prime, then what can you say about f bar? F bar doesn't have distinct factors, right? If f bar had distinct factors, then there will be more primes. By that philosophy, so f bar doesn't have distinct factors, meaning f bar has only one factor. What is the meaning of saying something has only one factor? It's a power of that factor. Okay, so we want to show that if P is the only prime lying above, we will show that f bar is the power of a polynomial. So so let's prove that. This is a corollary to the corollary one. So let fx in ax be a monic polynomial, leading coefficient is 1, which is also irreducible, okay, in kx. So the advantage here is, here I am not, so this is, you know, I use that philosophy to motivate this result, but here I don't have the condition that B is generated by one element. I'm arguing without that condition. So I don't have minimal polynomial of anything. I'm just taking any polynomial which is monic and irreducible in kx. Okay. And also assume that f has one root alpha in B. Under this condition, I'm going to show that f bar is a power of an irreducible polynomial. F bar cannot have distinct factors. Okay. Assume f has one root alpha in B. Now, if alpha 1 and alpha 2 are any two roots, so I haven't stated the result. Result will come at the end. I'm giving you the proof straight away. Suppose you take two roots of f bar in a given algebraic closure of A by B. Okay, fix two roots, alpha 1 and alpha 2. Then you have already assumed that f has one root alpha in B. So can you give me homomorphisms? Now I'm going to apply corollary 1. So can you give me the psi i's? Can you give me the psi i's? So what we have is, you have assumed that f has one root alpha in B, and I have taken two roots of f bar, alpha 1 and alpha 2. So alpha going to alpha 1 will generate a homomorphism, let's call it psi 1, and alpha going to alpha 2 will generate another morphism, let's call that psi 2. Okay, so from this, whatever we have, if alpha 1 and alpha 2 are any two roots of f bar, then consider psi I, this map, which sends, which is generated by alpha going to alpha I. Why should this generate a morphism? Yeah, maybe I did not think about it clearly.
Now, are we not assuming that B is separable over A for B?
B is, see, yes, correct, you are right, yeah. So we do have, yeah, thanks, I just forgot that. We are assuming that L over K is separable. Our assumption is L over K is gamma. Okay, separability, you know, we had that argument for the residue fields. Residue fields, you know, we did not assume separability, etc. Or Lang did not assume, we might have assumed. But L over K is always separable. But even then, L over K is separable, yes, Manav, and therefore?
No, I was talking about the fact that we had assumed just two sides ago that B over A is separable, right?
What is the meaning of B over A is separable?
Sorry, B bar over A bar.
B bar over A bar, yes, I assume that, and therefore?
So I'm thinking that then B bar is generated by one element. Is that alpha maybe?
Yeah, there is an argument which is required. So I frankly did not think about it while doing this. We need an argument because I am saying that, you know, this gives you, so we want to say that, we need to give one more argument because finally I'm getting a map from B to A by B bar. So I would like, so if I take, I'll come back to it, okay? It needs a small thought, but let's do this. Let's give the broad argument and we'll come back to it at the very end, okay? So I want to say that these give you morphisms from B to A by P bar. And once you have that, so there is something which we need to fix it. We want to say that this does give morphism from B itself. In which case, by corollary 1, you know that psi 1 and psi 2 will differ by a Galois element. So psi 1 and psi 2 will differ by some Galois element. If I call it sigma inverse, then by our assumption, what is our assumption? Our assumption is that P is the only prime lying above P. Okay. So sigma is in GP because P is the only prime lying above P is same as saying GP is equal to the Galois group. So sigma inverse is in the Galois group. So sigma is in the Galois group. Galois group is GP. And therefore, if sigma is in GP, then sigma bar belongs to Galois group of B bar over A bar because bar is well defined if you take something in GP. So this is where, from this to this is where we have used the fact that P is the only prime lying above P. Okay, that is used here by our assumption. Okay, so sigma bar is here. And if sigma bar is in Galois group of B bar over A bar, then what can you say? Yeah, so sigma bar is in this. And what is the property of sigma bar? Sigma bar has the property that sigma bar of alpha 1 is alpha 2. Why is that? because alpha 1 is the image of psi 1 and alpha 2 is the image of psi 2 and psi 1 is psi 2 composed sigma inverse. So if you apply sigma bar of alpha 1, you will get alpha 2. Small check. This is basically what it says is that psi 1 is psi 2 composed sigma inverse. And psi 1 is this, psi 2 is this. From that, it follows that sigma bar of alpha 1 is alpha 2. So what have we achieved? If you take any two roots of f bar, if you take arbitrarily two roots of f bar, you have produced a Galois element, Galois of b bar over a bar, which takes alpha 1 to alpha 2. So what can you say? So this shows that f bar cannot have distinct irreducible factors, right? Because if f bar has these two distinct irreducible factors, then Galois group will correspond to roots of one irreducible polynomial. Galois conjugates will be roots of one irreducible polynomials. But any two roots of f bar are Galois conjugates. Therefore, it cannot have two distinct factors. So it follows that f bar is a power of an irreducible polynomial in a bar x. Because otherwise, if it's not the power of one polynomial, if there are two irreducible polynomials, and if I pick alpha 1 a root of one of that and alpha 2 a root of another irreducible factor, there cannot be a Galois element conjugating those two. Because Galois conjugates are all part of one irreducible factor. So it follows that f bar is a power of an irreducible polynomial. Oh, what happened? So, so we have proved everything except one ambiguous thing is that, so the only hitch in this proof is I'm not assuming anything about B. So maybe, you know, I can rewrite this proof. No, so I'm just thinking aloud. I did not think about it before the class. So pay attention. I will change this part and let's see whether the proof go through. So if alpha 1 and alpha 2 are any roots of F bar, I know that alpha is in B. So instead of typing B here, let me type A bracket alpha. That's okay, no? So A bracket alpha to A by P bar, I can define psi I. Right? You agree? And then the proof goes through.
Yes.
So I think that's all that I need to do. So the result is true without our assumption that it's generated by one element. I don't need B is generated by one element, which may not be true, you see. That's why, you know, I don't want to stress that. That is not always true. So we may be in number field situation. We may be in a situation where B is not generated by one element. But the remark in Lang is, and we will also see later, what is true is if you localize at one prime, then you have BP and AP. You have infinitely many primes, right? Z has infinitely many prime numbers. Similarly, all these rings of integers will have infinitely many prime IDs. You pick one prime and you localize. So you will get A subscript small p and B subscript capital P. And the remark in Lang, which is true, which we might see later, we might prove later or we may not, I don't know what is in store for us. What is true is BP, B subscript capital P is generated over A subscript small p by one element is true. Well, not always. It's almost always true. Meaning, except for finitely many primes, this is true. So there are infinitely many prime IDs, and except for finitely many primes, what are called bad primes, bad, quote unquote, bad primes, this is always true. That result is useful in that sense. After localization, almost all primes, the result that we proved earlier is true. But here I don't need to assume that. So I think this is okay. We can just change B to A bracket alpha and then argue with that. A bracket alpha, of course, this will generate. and I can apply corollary 1 to that situation. So where will I be applying corollary 1? I will be applying corollary 1 to the situation. Yeah, this is for any ring extension, right? So I will apply it to A bracket alpha. So this goes through. So this is fine. So this sigma of L over K will be what? L will be what? L will be the quotient field of A bracket alpha. Quotient field of A bracket alpha. Still, there is, you know, one more small thing to consider. So this will be an in-between field, and in corollary 2, you will get a sigma from the Galois group of that, but that doesn't matter. That doesn't matter because so that will be some E here. So this sigma inverse will be Galois group of E over K, where E is the quotient field of A bracket alpha. But that doesn't matter because the full Galois group is GP by our assumption, and my field E is in between. Yeah, will it matter? See, my claim is that I think it's okay. I can argue with that Galois group. So there will be Galois group of E over K, and all these Galois groups will be the corresponding decomposition groups. Yeah, so I should say here also, if P is the only prime lying above P in B, you intersect with, you know, the corresponding ring here. So I have written A alpha, right? You intersect with the corresponding ring there, and that's only prime lying above. So that will be the only prime lying above P there. And we will argue with that setup, and I think that's okay. So I will think about it a bit more and modify the slides before putting it on Moodle. I think it goes through. So you will get sigma in GP, and you have got this, and therefore F bar is a power of an irreducible polynomial in A bar X. Yeah, I think it's okay. We will argue with the field in between, and all these arguments will go through, and that will show that F bar cannot have two distinct factors. Yeah, see, the point is whether I take, you know, L or the in-between field E, etc., this argument about, you know, distinct factors, that's an argument about A bar of X. So that doesn't matter. The field above that I'm considering, the final argument is about A bar of X. So it's okay. So I think what I said is okay. I will change this to A alpha and redo the argument. Okay. So what is the corollary here? If P is the only prime lying above P, and if you take any irreducible monic polynomial, which has at least one root in your B, then that polynomial, when you reduce mod P, F bar, it can only have one irreducible factor. It has to be a power of an irreducible factor. So that corresponds to this being the only prime. So this fits well with our earlier explicit description, which was more restrictive. So we have thrown away a restriction, and we are still getting that philosophy here. Okay. Now let me introduce some more things, and then I will state the corollary 3. I said there are 3 corollaries in Lang to this important theorem of surjectivity. Let's come to number fields for the third corollary. So K is a number field. What's the definition of a number field? What is a number field? Okay, maybe I verbally said it sometime, but here is a definition. A number field by definition is a finite, underline finite, a finite extension of the field of rational numbers Q. A finite extension of Q is what is called a number field. This is what one studies in algebraic number theory. So OK is its ring of algebraic integers. So what is an algebraic integer? It is an element of K, your number field, which is integral over, can you complete the sentence? Integral over. So K contains Q. And the element should be integral over z. Integral over z. So these are all the algebraic integers, all the elements of K which are integral over z. In other words, it is the integral closure of z in K. That is what we call OK. Ring of algebraic integers. P is a prime ideal of OK. We are going to prove later that OK is an example of a ring of dimension 1. We are going to prove later that OK is Noetherian, OK is integrally closed, and OK has the property that its length is 1, its Krull dimension is 1. So such integral domains have a name. They are called Dedekind domains. Dedekind domain is an integral domain commutative with 1, which have the three properties. One is Noetherian, second is integrally closed, and third is dimension 1, Krull dimension 1. And these are rings of integers in number fields are the most important examples of Dedekind domains. That's why I said we will not worry about prime ideals. Maximal is enough for us because we will have automatically. We need to prove all these things. And we have already seen in one of the classes that under Noetherian and integrally closed, we have proved an important finite generation statement. So that will be useful later. Okay, so P is a prime ideal of OK, which is also maximal. And K is, I mean, if it's non-zero, it's maximal. K is a finite extension of K, so that's also a number field. And we are going to introduce this definition. P splits completely in K. Okay, so splits completely. What is the meaning of that? That means if the number of primes in O capital K lying above P, this equals, would you like to take a guess from the English word splits completely? How many primes are lying above? That equals what? So what is the feeling that you get from the English word splits completely?
Some sort of dimension.
Yeah, so that means, you know, it's like factorizing linearly, right? If you have a polynomial which factorizes linearly, no, not factorizing linearly, factorizing without multiplicity, without common roots, that is splits completely. So lying above P equals the degree of K over K. That's a finite number, no? It's a finite extension. And this degree is equal to the number of primes lying above. Then we say that P splits completely. So if, you know, if your extension is Galois, I'm not assuming K over K is Galois. Suppose K over K is Galois, then this is same as the degree of the order of the Galois group, right? This is same as the order of the Galois group. So what can you say about the decomposition group? Take capital P lying above P. Take one capital P lying above P. What can you say about the decomposition group at that capital P? If P splits completely, then there are how many primes are there above? Equal to the order of the Galois group. So what can you say about the decomposition group?
One, right?
One, correct. So if K over K is Galois, then P splits completely in K if and only if GP is 1. I hope it's clear to others also. Otherwise, think about it. It's obvious. Because if GP is 1, if decomposition group is 1, then no prime above is fixed. So corresponding to distinct Galois elements, you will get distinct primes. So number of primes lying above will be equal to the degree of K over K. On the other hand, if number of primes is equal to the degree of K over K, which is same as the order of the Galois group, then that shows that each sigma in the Galois group is giving you a distinct prime. Because only then the number of primes can be equal to the Galois group. In other words, nothing is fixing a given prime. So GP is 1. So P splits completely in K if and only if GP is 1. Okay. Now in the last class, yeah, again a typo, a class is missing. So in the last class, we had a characterization of the decomposition field. Recall once again, what was the characterization? I recalled it at the starting, but one of you recall it again. It is the smallest extension of K contained
we have L. only one prime ideal lying over.
Yeah, the corresponding prime down. There's exactly one prime lying over. So that property is certainly true for the decomposition field, but the characterization is it is the smallest such field. Okay. Now we want to give another characterization. We will have one more characterization for the decomposition field in terms of primes splitting completely. But this is not very general. For this, we need to assume that K over K is Galois and abelian. Earlier also we had Galois, but we did not have any further condition. Here we will assume that K over K is abelian, meaning the Galois group is abelian. Okay, so it's a restrictive condition. Under this condition, we will have another characterization, and this is that KD is the decomposition field, is the maximal. So earlier we said smallest, now we are saying largest. Is the maximal subfield of K containing K in which P splits completely. Okay. So earlier we said that it's the smallest sub-extension such that capital P above is the only prime lying above the corresponding prime here. Only prime lying above and the smallest. Now it is the largest for splitting completely, for small P splitting completely. So earlier it was the smallest and the property was with respect to the capital P above. Now it is the largest with respect to a property of the small p below. Okay, earlier smallest with respect to a capital P above, some property about that, which was like only prime lying above. Now the property is splitting completely, but it's about the small prime below and it is the largest. Okay, so let's prove this. And this is corollary 3 of our surjectivity research. So first of all, KD is Galois over K. Why is that? See, if you have L, capital K over K Galois, and KD is contained inside, K over KD is automatically Galois. But KD over K need not be Galois in general, but we have KD over K Galois. Why? Why? It's, the answer is there in this slide. Answer is there here.
Abelian, so every subgroup is normal.
Yeah, every group, every subgroup is normal because of abelianness. And then KD over K will be Galois, and the Galois group also, you know, it will be G by GP. Because K over KD, Galois group is GP. So this is the quotient group. Quotient is a group because GP is normal in G, because G is abelian. So write the quotient decomposition. G will be I going from 1 to the degree of KD over K, sigma I GP. One of the sigma I's is identity element. This is the quotient decomposition. Sigma I's are distinct. Okay, this is the quotient decomposition. And let us call Q as earlier capital P. So what is capital P? Capital P is a prime lying above, one prime lying above small p, and we have taken the decomposition group and intersected with KD. That will be a prime in Q. That will be a prime ideal in Q. So we know that P is the only prime lying above Q. Why is that? That's a characterization. I mean, that's because KD is the decomposition field. We already have this. We have more. This is the smallest such field, but that we don't need here. P is the only prime lying above Q is because it's a decomposition field. Now we claim that sigma I, if you apply to Q, they are prime ideals of the decomposition ring, the integral closure of A in the decomposition field. Why are they prime ideals? Because sigma i's are Galois elements. See, what do you need to show? You need to show that, the point is, the point is, see, if you have a Galois element, and if you have a prime ideal, then sigma of P is of course a prime ideal. That's not the point. The point is sigma I's are Galois elements of K over K, capital K over K. But the point is this sigma I restricted to KD takes KD to KD. See, in general, it would have taken KD to K, but it takes KD to KD because of abelianness. KD over K is Galois. Therefore, sigma is can be considered as these are elements of G by GP, which is identified with Galois group of KD over K. So sigma I restricted to KD is an element of the Galois group of KD over K. Therefore, you know, you can apply this. And these are prime elements of, prime is obvious. These are ideals of OD and they will be primes because sigma is can be identified, okay, belongs to is abuse of notation because sigma is are actually in G, these are causal representatives, but it's restriction, yeah. Sigma I restricted to KD belong to Galois group of KD over K. And sigma I applied to capital P is the only prime lying above sigma I of Q. That's because P is the only prime lying above Q. Because P is the only prime lying above Q, it follows that sigma IP is the only prime lying above sigma IQ. From this, you can conclude that, and you know that the sigma is a coset representative. So because sigma is a coset representative, you know that sigma 1 of P cannot be equal to sigma 2 of P. Sigma I of P cannot be sigma j of P. Why is that? Because if sigma I of P equal to sigma j of P, then sigma I, sigma j inverse will belong to GP. But these are distinct coset representatives. Therefore, sigma I of P not equal to sigma j of P. So since sigma I is a coset representative, all the sigma I P are distinct. But if sigma I P are distinct, then I claim that sigma I Q are distinct. Why? This argument we used in the last class also. Sigma I P are distinct, then sigma I Q are distinct. Because if sigma I Q equal to sigma j Q, then sigma IP and sigma JP are two different primes lying over the same prime. But that contradicts only prime lying above. So because of the only prime lying above, because of the distinctness of this, sigma IQ are also distinct. Sigma IQ are distinct. But then what is the, what did you get? How many sigma IQs are there? If they are all distinct, then how many are there? Exactly this number, corresponding to each sigma I. So you have got that P splits completely in KD. So we have proved that P splits completely in KD, which is what we wanted to prove. No, we wanted to prove two things. We wanted to prove that this is the maximal extension with this property. So first of all, we proved P splits completely in KD. Now we have to prove that this is maximal for that property. In other words, if there is any other extension with this property that P splits completely there, we want to show that that extension is contained in KD. Okay, so let's do that. Suppose there is an F in between K and K with this property that P splits completely in F, consider its Galois group. K over K is abelian, okay? So you can consider this Galois group anyway, you can consider Galois group of K over F, and consider P intersection F to be PF. And the decomposition group of PF must be trivial. This is an argument that we saw earlier because we are assuming P splits completely in F. So decomposition group of PF has to be trivial. Now if sigma belongs to GP, what do we need to show? We need to show that F is contained in KD. F is contained in KD is same as showing GP is contained in H by the fundamental theorem of Galois theory. So we have to show that GP is contained in H. So take something in GP and you have to show that sigma belongs to H. So take sigma in GP, then sigma of PF is PF. Why is that? That follows from the definition of PF, because sigma of PF is sigma of P intersection F, which is sigma of P intersection sigma of F. But sigma of F is F. Why is that? Sigma of F is F as a set. Not, I'm not saying sigma fixes element wise. Sigma of F is F because F over K is Galois. F over K is Galois because the whole thing is abelian. So this is a normal subgroup. So this is Galois. And because of that, sigma of F is F. So sigma of P intersection sigma of F is P intersection F, which is PF. Why is sigma of P equal to P? Because sigma belongs to GP. That's the definition of GP, sigma of P equal to P. So this follows, and therefore, sigma restricted to F is identity. Why is that? Why is this? This is also there in the slides. What is the meaning of saying sigma of PF equal to PF? Sigma belongs to the decomposition group of PF, right? This means sigma belongs to the decomposition group of PF, but because of P splitting completely, what do you know about the decomposition group? Decomposition group is trivial. Sigma belongs there, therefore sigma is trivial. So sigma is trivial, trivial meaning identity element. So sigma restricted to F is trivial. And if sigma restricted to F is trivial, then what can you say? If sigma belongs to the full Galois group and if its restriction to F is trivial, then sigma belongs to H. So what you have shown is if sigma is in GP, then sigma belongs to H. So GP is contained in H. GP is a subgroup of H. But if GP is a subgroup of H, then ulta, the other way, extension. So GP corresponds to KD. That will contain the field corresponding to H, which is F. Field corresponding to F is F. Field corresponding to H is F. So that shows KD contains F. F is contained in KD. So we have shown both ways. We have shown that KD is maximal for the property P splits completely in KD. Why is this a corollary to what we have shown? Why is this a corollary? Why is this not a new result? These are all things that we have done long back. They are all distinct. So P splits completely, that's a definition. And the other way, if P splits completely, you can consider this, you can consider this. And the decomposition group of P is trivial. We haven't used anything, no? Because our result was GP to the Galois group of finite extensions, that is surjective. And then we had two corollaries of that. And that's what you're also saying, right? We don't see any of that being used.
Yeah.
Once again, he does state it as a corollary. So this is where we are starting, right? This is where we are starting. This is just group theory. And this is just taking intersection. P is the only prime lying above Q. That is something about decomposition group. And these are prime ideals of OD. That's something general. Yeah, anyway, the proof is clear. And yeah, I don't think we are using it. Okay, let me introduce, yeah, it's already 3:20. Let me just introduce these two terms, Frobenius and R10. So we have a number field K, its ring of integers OK. Capital K is a finite extension of K, so that's another number field. Its ring of integers O capital K. P is a prime in OK, prime ideal in OK, which is also maximal. And capital P is a prime lying above P in O capital K. These are the notations. Assume K over K is Galois. We are not assuming abelian, just Galois. The residue field OK by P is finite. See, this will be an extension of, this will be a finite extension of z mod pz for some p, and therefore it is finite. So the proof that this is finite is basically z mod pz is finite. So let's call it fq, where q will be some power of p. If the if ok is the integral closure of if p intersection z will be a prime ideal in z, if that prime is p, this will be that prime p, and it will be some power of that, okay, for a prime number p. Now ok by capital P is a finite extension of ok by p, so that will be f q power f for some f. Agree with all this, where q itself is a prime power, some prime number p, and this will be a finite extension of that, so that will be some fq, and this will be some fq power f, okay. And we have an isomorphism gp by tp. What is tp? This is the inertia subgroup at p. So we have an isomorphism gp by tp, isomorphic to Galois group of the residue field extensions fq power f by fq. But what is Galois group of fq power f by fq? What is the order of this, what is the degree of this extension?
F.
So what is this Galois group? It is cyclic
group of order f.
Cyclic group of order f, z mod fz. And there is a very well known generator of this Galois group, right? What is it called? What is the generator of this Galois group? X going to, there's a well known automorphism of fq power f whose fixed points are fq. If you take x here, then x going to, x going to x power, x going to x power q, right? Fq will consist of solutions of x power q equal to x. So if you take x going to x power q, that's an automorphism. See, that's an automorphism, that's a field automorphism, because you are in characteristic p. X plus y power q is x power q plus y power q, all the other binomial coefficients are zero. So x going to x power q is a automorphism, and that's a generator, that's a generator of this. This is what is called the Frobenius automorphism, right? You must have seen this in field theory, no? Have you seen this? Yeah, Frobenius automorphism. So this is the Frobenius automorphism, which is, so the Galois group is generated by the Frobenius automorphism. So under this natural isomorphism, the Frobenius map goes to the generator here, which is 1, right? This is cyclic group and the generator is 1, no? So that is mapped to the Frobenius. So the Frobenius is there here, and you have a natural canonical reduction map here. So the Frobenius, if you lift here, take the pre-image, what will you get? You will get some element sigma and the coset of that, sigma t beta, sigma tp. Okay, that is what is called any element in the pre-image coset. So pre-image will be a coset of tp, and any one element in that coset, in that set, is called a Frobenius automorphism of p. This is the definition of Frobenius automorphism. Okay, it is by definition any one element in the coset corresponding to the usual Frobenius morphism in finite field theory. This is denoted by capital P comma K over K bracket bracket. Okay, this is a notation. And you can check easily that if you take sigma a Galois element, and if you take sigma P, the Frobenius corresponding to sigma P, you want to take a guess? Last time I asked you to take a guess, and same guess you can take. What will be the relationship between the Frobenius at sigma P and the Frobenius at P?
Composition
of
sigma with
it's not the composition. Last time also maybe you or someone else said composition, but it's a conjugation. It's a composition, but on both sides, conjugation. You can check. Okay, so it is sigma times the Frobenius at p times sigma inverse. Okay, so this is an easy check. Please do that. And I will also introduce Artin morphism and stop there. So Ferdinand Frobenius was a German mathematician, and in fact on Wikipedia, you know, there's a sub wiki page called the list of things named after Frobenius, and there are some 20-30 things named after Frobenius, so very, very well-known famous mathematician. And Emil Artin, of course, you have seen. How many times we mentioned Emil Artin's name in these lectures? In the very first lecture we mentioned, because we proved the Artin-Weber theorem. And then in lecture 4 also we mentioned, I did not write it, but I said verbally, because we computed a certain index in norm, right? We computed the index of k star by k star power n, and I said Lang says that the proof is due to Emil Artin. The proof that Lang has is due to Emil Artin. So whom we have already seen in lecture 1 and lecture 4 was an Austrian mathematician of Armenian descent. So this I did not know. Is this a spelling of descent? Yeah, I guess. Anyway, this must be correct because I copy-pasted from Wikipedia, so I didn't type that. So this must be correct. Okay, so let me introduce Artin morphism. Artin morphism is a particular case of Frobenius morphism. So recall, you said that, I mean, we said that we can check that this is conjugation of the original Frobenius. Now assume K over K is abelian. So if K over K is abelian, what is the right-hand side? See, this belongs to the Galois group. And then you are multiplying by sigma and sigma inverse. Composition is the multiplication. So if K over K is abelian, the Galois group is abelian, what will be the right-hand side? Sigma and sigma inverse will cancel. No, if it's abelian, sigma inverse can be taken here, it will cancel. So it will be just P. It will be the original Frobenius. And also assume that the inertia is trivial. So what is the definition of Frobenius? Frobenius is any one element in the coset of the Frobenius on finite fields in the inertia subgroup. So you, if inertia is trivial, there is no coset to consider. It's a singleton. So if K over K is abelian, then it does not depend on the prime above, right? Any prime above will be sigma p for some p, but it does not depend on the prime above. All those are Frobenii are same. And if it is singleton. So if you assume K over K is abelian and the inertia is trivial, then GP is same for every P. Right? GP is same for every P, you have seen last time, because G sigma P is a conjugate of GP, but conjugate is same as this thing because of abelianness. So all the GPs are same. It follows that for each prime downstairs in the smaller field K, you have a unique element of GP given by the Frobenius, and which now we denote by, because now it no longer depends on capital P, because GP is same for all capital P, and this also is same for all capital P, because sigma P and P, the Frobenius are same. So Frobenius is actually on capital P, but in the abelian case, when TP is trivial, there's a unique element, the unique Frobenius, it does not depend on P, it depends only on the prime below. And therefore our new notation will be small p instead of capital P. This makes sense only in the abelian situation, because otherwise, you know, Frobenius is capital P. But in the abelian situation, the Frobenius capital P is independent of the P that you are taking. So it depends only on small p. So we have this new notation, and this is called the Artin automorphism. So Artin automorphism is nothing but the Frobenius automorphism, but in this particular case. In the case where K over K is abelian and the inertia is trivial, this is the Artin automorphism. All these things are very, very important concepts in number theory and actually quite modern mathematics. But I don't think we will do all that, but at least let's introduce the basic concepts. Okay, so I think our time is up. We will stop here. And so let me stop the class here. Stop sharing and stop recording. Any question, Manav?
No.
Anyway, I'll stop recording.